gives people a chance to log in and.
Today. I'm greeting those also that are connecting with us online this morning and letting you know that we're still one church and one family. We're grateful for that. Some are migrating back and doing the in-person worship with us. We're doing our best to still practice the safe distancing here and being comfortable, but we are slowly bringing people into the place where we can have that experience of worshiping together. If you're still not able to do that or not comfortable doing that, it's okay. Please continue to log in with us and connect with us and give us the feedback. If you've logged in on this live feed right now, please know you can check in and let people know that you're here. You may get some feedback from some of them as they say hello to each other. But also I want to remind you there's a chance that you can click a link there that's called hosting a watch party. And if you do that, then it sends the link over to your feed. And it lets people then join you that are your friends, maybe not parts of our church, that are your circle of friends that can watch with you. And you may be able to bring some other people to and understand what we do here at Pleasant Retreat and share worship with them in that way. And if you're not on Facebook at all, don't panic. We post this service also as we make a copy and send it right over to YouTube. Our YouTube channel is Pleasant Retreat UMC, Tyler, Texas. Boy, I've been here almost 7 years. I'm still trying to get that straight, but it's Pleasant Retreat UMC, Tyler, Texas. And if you go to that YouTube channel there, you can see and connect with all the worship services that we have each week. We do that for both our 9 o'clock traditional service and our 11 o'clock service that we do as well. So this fresh start service will be at 11, and 9 o'clock is our traditional service. I'm also letting you know that as you're willing to, give us feedback, let us know then how we're doing and what we can do to make the service better for you. And for those of you here, thank you for being a part of this and making the journey to be with us. It's slowly coming back, but it's not exactly the same yet, but we're coming to that, and we're grateful for that. I want to thank you for being a part of service because you bring something to it. It's not just something that we do and hand off. It's something that we share. And the sharing today will be significant. My name is Richard Luna. I'm the pastor here. Been here 6 years, almost seven now, like I said. And I'm blessed every Sunday that we gather. And the truth is, God has a blessing for us today. I'm going to light the candles on our altar. And if you're at home, I encourage you to have a candle that you would light as your Christ candle, signaling the ways in which Christ joins us in this experience. You know, Scripture tells us we're two or more gathered. And the truth is that we just need to welcome and acknowledge Christ already with us. And that's what the light means. Christ is always with us. And now join me for a prayer. Father God, we ask that in this time of worship, that you give us the source of joy and expression in our heart and lives that allow us to find a truth to the words that we sing, that we share, that we hear. Let us also remember the ways in which your word will speak not just to community, but to us personally. Challenge us, change us, and make us different when we leave. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And if you're comfortably able to stand and sing along to our opening hymns and call to worship and following him, and those at home, please, you have the grace in front of you, sing at home as well. Bye. together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
To not just pray for the things that we need from day to day. We give God so often our laundry list of things that we want, but it also gives us an experience to find that balance in our lives where we really do consider all the gifts and the blessings of God as well. And we take those with an inventory, and we acknowledge the ways that God has already given us. Well, our tradition in the church is that God has always equipped the church. I don't know if you know, but this church here is about 167 years old. We have a long history. And I had the joy not too long ago on one of our Heritage Sundays going back and looking through some of that history. And it started occurring to me that there were some years that this church saw some tough times with its community. There was the Depression. There was the years of war. There have been times in which the church has been challenged and pushed to its limits along with everyone else who is a people of faith. And yet we have continued to keep the gospel and the mission of the church as the forefront of what we do. We're still here. And I guess I can want to stand at this point and say, you know, for whatever the case may be, we find ourselves being challenged at times. And we're in a challenging time now where we're finding this balance that we must do between digital and live and all the resources around the experiences that we've been through. We didn't know it was going to last this long or that it was going to carry over this way. But I think in some ways it's growing us into something better that will last even longer. And I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful that God has always been there when the church is needed, when the people of God have needed, and when you have needed him the most. Isn't it a blessing to consider that as the foundation whenever we begin to ask God for anything? You know, I love the fact that when you have this relationship where you've already witnessed the willingness of God to love us, that it frees us to truly ask for the deepest need of our heart and spirit. And today, as we come together as God's people, we have prayer needs that are around us. If you haven't already had the opportunity, Lindsay sends out each week an order of service, and then she makes available also this prayer list that lets us as a community pray for those who have asked for prayer. You may not know everybody on there, some you will, and you'll know the circumstance. But whatever the case, praying by name is a way in which we remember with God the blessing of each person. And according to whatever that need is, God will respond when the power of prayer is created by God's people. And so I invite you to print that list out or resource it and use it as maybe a daily prayer guide to pray for all those things that are needed in our community of faith. Some are outside of our church, and that's okay. We pray for each other always. I want to give you specific prayer needs today for Joyce Evans. Her husband, Curtis, passed away last Sunday morning, and we had his graveside service yesterday. Joyce is now beginning a journey of her own now after 62 years of marriage, of being on her own without Curtis. And her family is there with her. She's staying with family. She's in good care. But I just know that that family needs our prayers right now still. I'm also asking prayers. Tammy is here this morning, but she had an injection yesterday and is on the mend from her treatment. Also, Herman Sidham is needing our prayers as he continues the journey with the diagnosis of leukemia, but he's deciding now to go ahead and move forward with some treatment and see how it works. Keep that family in your prayers as well. Jessica Stidham this past week also had an implant done for a stimulation to her back with some back pain that she's been dealing with for a long time. There's a long history there, and she's recovering from the surgery and all the conditions of that right now first, and for about 2 weeks, and then they'll turn this device on, and hopefully we'll see some fruit from that, where she gets the benefit from the pain being reduced. Keep her and he in your prayers as they make this journey for the next 2 weeks together in her healing. I'm also asking prayers for the church as a whole. You've been diligent in praying for the staff and the people here, but you know, every church is going through some experiences right now. I was having a conversation earlier, but you know, one of the challenges for the church is going to be bringing people back. How do we do that responsibly, but also how do we motivate people to know how personal it can be to be a part of a church family and not just someone you see on TV. And my prayer is that we'll continue to be a presence for Christ in that way, and that slowly but surely people will see you can't replace the relationships you build in a church family. Then now that being said, Ryan and Samantha still need your prayers this week as we move towards a shower for them and their wedding. We have joys and celebrations to consider also. I've said enough with all that. I want to ask you to join me in a congregational prayer where we pray as a church family, and then we use that moment also to pray for you, every one of you and your individual needs. You are not any different in God's eyes. You are a child of God, and he is here fully to resource your life and your living. Let's take honor with that and use this moment to embrace God as he embraces us. Will you join me in prayer? Father God, I thank you for the gift of prayer that is ours. So often we use it as a vice, a resource, a fallback to the times that we need it the most. The times that you hear from us are usually in our moments of need. But I ask today that even the person who has the least reason to pray would feel empowered to pray. Because we are people that are blessed. We are people that are given this opportunity to not just pray for ourselves, but pray for each other. And there is no reason why we could ever consider doing this day without prayer. And so we come to you this morning and we embrace you. And we ask God that we could be awakened to how near you are in this present moment. That we're not praying to a distant God, but we're praying to a God who's standing and wrapping his arms around us and holding us as we say our words. The truth is, we're not saying anything that you don't already know. We're not telling you anything. But when we speak in prayer, God, whether it's silently to our heart, through our hearts and our minds, or openly with our mouth, we find and discover that it's more of awakening for ourselves. Because finding the words sometimes is the very pathway to realizing the gift we have in this relationship with you. And so, God, help us to resource enough to know that while you know the deepest need of our heart even before we speak, your spirit groans for us in the very things that we can ourselves put words to. You still treasure those moments that we can lean upon you and give you thanks or ask for your strength. Today, I pray for all of us that we'll have this moment in this time together to give you the thanks for the blessings that we've seen and to have our eyes opened to all the blessings we've overlooked. Awaken us, Lord, to the richness of your love that is there before we ever ask or need. In the same moment, God, awaken us to your strength and free us from this burden that we create in ourselves sometimes to do it all on our own. We haven't asked others to pray for us, and we haven't asked you to lead us. And God, it's such a resource. I think Jesus knew this when his disciples approached him. What they wanted from him was a practice of prayer, but what he gave them was a sense of the community and the connection of prayer. they asked for words, and he gave them more than words. He gave them the relationship with God. And God who walks with us, forgives us, sustains us, and leads us, and fulfills his promise. And I think it was a powerful thing when Jesus began that prayer with the words, "Our Father," because that hour made that connection with every disciple who was with him, that we're in this together with Jesus in our lives. And calling you Father collectively makes us all reminded of the ways that we're connected by Christ and through Christ to you, O Lord. And so today we embark in a spirit that says, Lord, if we can give to you the things that we don't need, we're free to do the work and the will that you have called us to be. And if we can give thanksgiving, we know that there's a God who will sustain us and carry us through all things. And so in the power and spirit of Jesus Christ, we remember today and share today the words that he taught us to pray as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but to deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We share in our scriptures this morning a reading from the book of Romans chapter 5, beginning with that first verse in that chapter. Listen carefully to the words of Paul as he writes to the Romans and tries to bring them a testament to the gospel itself. He says, Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Those are some powerful words that Paul throws out there. They're words that speak to the very heart of what we believe at times, although we still have some trouble believing it for ourselves. I don't know about you, but there are days when I find myself in a place where I'm thinking that God really does love his children. He really does love the people of this world. I get it. I understand it, and I want to share that. But privately, there are moments when I wonder, how can he really love me? I'm just being honest with you. And I'm going to guess that at some point you know exactly what I'm talking about. How can God really love me? Well, today I want to remind you that one of the features of our discipleship is that we partner with a God who knows us very well. And it is very personal. And for each of us, the message today is that God knows your when. In these weeks to come, we're going to talk about God knows your why, God knows other things about us, but today, God knows your when is the message I want you to hear. You see, this passage tells us that God is a very timely God, and it's with intention. It's not like the timing that we do. You know, if someone treats you good, you want to send a thank you note, don't you? And you want to give back. We sometimes get embarrassed by it. We don't know. We immediately start planning how we can give back to the one who's doing something for us. I remember I was at Pollard Methodist Church and fairly new in the ministry there with them. And the music director, Arnold Sherman, decided to take me out to eat one day. And so we went out and we had lunch together, and he bought my lunch. And we were headed back towards the church and busy and talking still, getting to know each other a little bit. And I said to him, thank you so much for lunch. I look forward to being able to buy your lunch one day too. And he slowed the car down, pulled over, looked at me, and he said, you don't get it. I'm doing this because I want to. And I got it. He wanted me to know I didn't owe him anything. His timing was his timing. Have you had people in your life that you can name and think about who have stepped in, and you don't know how, you don't know, you can't figure it out, but it's like they sense something, they know something, and they show up in the most unexpected moment with the very need that you have in that moment. Maybe it was just someone who showed up out of nowhere and said to you, I want you to know I'm praying for you. I care about you. And you don't know how to handle that sometimes. Because those are the moments that we tend to think that no one really understands or knows what we're going through. And I think those are moments in which God himself is trying to say to you, I know your when. I know when your heart is burdened. I know when your joy is restored and complete. I know everything about you. And the deepest need is something that even before you understand it, I understand it. you know, Paul writes these words and he tells us about a faith where we witness this God of our life who loves us, and he loves us enough to give us the very grace that we can't earn or deserve on our own. But through Jesus Christ, he says, we access that kind of grace. In other words, you're never going to know the full grace of God until you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. When you do that, the doors open and you really begin to taste not just a random God who shows up, but a God who's always available. A God who will pour out his love upon you and lavish you with grace. There's a truth about grace that we all need to know too in this, that grace only has one source, and that's God. You won't get that kind of grace from anywhere else. And secondly, God chooses to give it, and he chooses the when. And God is so understanding of your when that you won't ever have an experience that you don't find his grace available. It may be that we're not accepting it, but it's available. God knows your when. Paul writes in this passage to us too, and he says that though we have obtained this grace in which we get to stand now, what we need to know is that we can do two things as a result of it. We can boast in our sharing about this glory of God. But then he takes it a step further, and he says, and not only for that, but we also boast in our sufferings. Anybody here want to testify to the way God's loving you right now and how proud you are that God's let you suffer? That he's making you struggle? And he's not just handing it to you? He's asking you to work for it? To deserve and earn it in some way? To own it in some way? You know, think about it. As you've been maturing as a child or an adult or a teenager even, and whatever the case may be, we have those experiences where we accomplish something and we feel really good about it. Maybe it was something simple, but we accomplished it. Y'all don't know this, but I'm embarking on a new territory in my life right now. I've decided that I want to go camping. I know, people shake their heads whenever I talk about this. It's like, oh, I wish I could just be there to watch this. So I bought a tent. And it got delivered. And I was so excited that yesterday I decided to put that tent up. And just you know, so it comes nicely wrapped in this neat little package and everything. And I thought, really, that's a whole tent right there? And I walked outside with it, and I found a shady spot, thank goodness. And I began to start putting the tent together. Well, it took a couple of videos on YouTube and some other things. But I eventually did succeed in getting the tent up. But I was so proud of myself. And then I'm reading in the print, and it says, 5 minutes set up. No. And more like 55, probably me. But I was so proud, I started sending pictures to my friends and video. And then someone said, are you going to leave that up on that? Oh. I got to take it down, too. And you know what? I discovered then how hard it was to put that tent back in the package that it came in. I'm thinking just get some rope and just tie it up in a ball or something. You know, I'm not sure. But anyway, I spent my day yesterday working on this tent, getting ready for this. And I got to tell you, when the day comes that I go and set up camp somewhere, which won't be long from now, I'm going to be proud a little bit. It may be nothing to anybody else around me. They may even make fun of me for the ways that I fumble and mess around. But deep inside, I'm going to say, you know what? I'm camping. And I like this. I like accomplishing this. God knows this about us, and his win for us is sometimes that we wouldn't just jump to it, but that we actually experience it. And there are times we will suffer. And that's just as important a time to boast of your faith in God as it is when things are going good. Paul adds a beautiful segment here to this, and you have heard it before, but just follow again the thinking that Paul lays out for us here, because it's in our suffering that we are producing endurance, and then endurance produces a character, and character produces a hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God is faithful. He says, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Well, I tell you what, when we get past the suffering and we get into the endurance and we move on to the character, we move on to the hope, what we discover in that hope is that God's grace is enough. And then Paul adds a piece to this that just turns me around, and I hope you're hearing it and feeling it today in the ways that it's really meant to be for you. I get it. I have days that I can celebrate God and His grace, His forgiveness for me. I'm justified in that grace. I'm empowered in that grace. That whole understanding of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that we celebrated a couple of Sundays ago is still guiding us in our journey today. And we embark on this life of discipleship knowing that God is with us. But then Paul adds some thinking to this for us that tells us that God knows the very when of your life and mine. You see, the real joy that we have is that it wasn't in the moments that we got it right. It was the moments that we were our weakest that God notices us. Probably in the moments that I thought that God wasn't able to know because I hadn't told Him and I'd hidden it well enough that He would never discover it, right? Maybe it was that moment in which I thought, you know, what God doesn't know, God doesn't know. God knows. And the moments that are my weakest, the moments in which I can't do it on my own, Paul writes, for while we were still weak, and then he says, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. At the right time. You know, one of the faith elements that we have is that we think of Christ dying on the cross as more of a historical thing, that justifying grace being a part of what He did for us at that time on the cross. But what Paul and others following this faith have told us and taught us is that there's an ongoing element to this too. Christ is still dying for the sins of the ungodly. The time that was then is still the time that we need even today. Even today, at the right time, Christ is dying for our sins. He says, indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. Well, give me a noble cause, and maybe I'll think about it. Make me a hero, and maybe I can do that. But that wasn't how it happened. Paul then writes, but more than that, let's see, that's not it. But God, verse 8, but God proves His love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I don't even know why I had to look that up, but I did. Verse 8. Highlight that verse in your Bible if you get a chance when you get home. And remember, that's for you. While we were yet sinners. And that could be today, that could be tomorrow, that could be the next day. It's already happened in some of our lives, right? Those moments that we needed the most, God knows our win. He knows this is the time that you need me, and this is the time that salvation will come and be available to you. The only thing that prevents it is me not knowing my when. I've joked about Paul before. I said, you know, I picture him in his journey and all the things he went through. We know that he suffered a lot, and he probably was terrible at support groups, where people would start telling their stories of how they suffered for the kingdom, you know, and the little sharing moments that he would have with others. They would say to him, well, you know, the persecutions, the things we've been through, and he would just be going, praise God! And they'd be going, you're not hearing me. No, it was tough. It was tough. People were dying. He's going, yes! Isn't it wonderful? He has this boldness about him that cuts right to the chase. What you don't see in that, if you only dwell on the suffering, is that you don't see the glory of God in that moment. Because while we were at our worst, while we were weakest, while we were yet sinners, not knowing what the right thing was to do, Christ intervenes and becomes the very gift of our need. And through him, we know that God knows our when. I pray that maybe we are more open to that possibility too. What happens in our living if you and I leave here today and we live as if God knows our when? God knows when you're happy. He knows when you feel successful. He knows when you feel accomplished. But he also knows when you feel less than yourself. And you feel doubting yourself, and you feel uncertain, and you feel possibly that you may even be on the fringe of being those that God would not want to forgive. And you can go to any degree you want to in that experience, and God knows the when of that need, and he'll have just enough grace to supply for whatever it is. But if we leave here believing that, what happens in the way that we relate to others? What happens when we encounter the person in our community right now that thinks that somehow or another, this is not for them? What happens when we encounter the person who says, that's great, I'm happy for you, but you don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've done. You don't know what I've gone through. Your witness. If you believe it and live it, is that, friend, God knows that when. God knows that very need. A lot of people today in our world, and including us too, could benefit from knowing the kind of God that knows us enough that he will always be ready for the win of your life. I thank you that God knows that for each of us. I pray for a world that still doesn't believe it. May we find the measure of grace that will not only let us celebrate and enjoy, be joyful in it, but maybe be bold enough to say it for the world. God knows your win. And he knows that right now is our win. Every moment is my win. When do I not need to be reminded that while I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit,
amen. Amen.
Friends, I invite you to do more than just hear the Word of God. If this has spoken to you in some way, find that gift that is yours right now in a response. It's between you and God. Invitation is something that we put on our bulletin. We do an invitation to Christian discipleship. It's listed there. But it's really nothing that I'm doing or anything that we create. It's between you and the very Christ who has died for you while you were yet a sinner. And it's that initial invitation then that speaks to your life now. It's more than words. It's an experience. And I pray today that you can respond to that in your heart and your spirit, but also with your singing. As we sing this song together of invitation, let us embark on the ways that it will speak to us and allow us to speak to the God who knows our men. Let's stand and let's sing together. God who knows their win through your love. Amen.